Let the past die. Kill it.
We aimed to try and do as much as we can in camera. The reality is there are always going to be shot sequences or big moments that are going to need visual effects. And on a film like this, it's a Star Wars movie. We ultimately ended up with over 2,000 effect shots in the film.
You have too much of your father's heart in you.
It took almost a year to get to the final look of Snoke, and it's an organic process. We start with a maquette. We copied that, we scanned it, we digitized it, brought it in, started to paint textures, started to build the internal controls and anatomy of that character. And then as the editors, Ryan and Bob, were working together, they brought together the sequences only using Andy's reference. And he had this incredible, powerful performance, a very resonant voice.
Closer, I said.
Young fool.
It was I who bridged your mind.
The amazing thing about Andy is he's incredibly skilled at doing this, and he's unafraid of the technology. So we were able to suit him up in an active motion capture suit so that we could actually film with infrared cameras from the ceiling of the set. That allowed him to walk around and perform unhindered. We also put a helmet on his head with 4 HD cameras so we could get very clear definition on his face. And then as we started to do animation tests and early dailies on the material, we got a few weeks into it and Ryan actually came to me and said, I'm not sure that the voice is actually matching the anatomy of the character that we've designed. And we realized there was an issue there. The initial design made it look like a very fragile, frail, older character, and Andy's voice is this booming, resonant, wonderful thing. So we actually had to open up the chest, we had to take some of the scoliotic distortion out of his spine, and we actually made him another 1.5 feet taller. So he's about 8, 8.5 feet, the final character. As soon as we did it, we knew we'd hit the right combination and we could move forward. The bombing run was in the original script, almost exactly as you see it in the film. We did bid how to execute the bombing run as a piece of miniature photography with motion control and bring all the layers in and composite them, practical pyrotechnics and everything. And the schedule and cost of that was just too prohibitive. But the important thing for me is, when working with a director like Ryan, is to communicate that we can make our CG look like any particular style of thing at the moment. We can make it look like a balsa wood model, a very shiny, modern, sort of CG-looking ship. We have that control over the way that we can render things now. And after a time, Ryan became confident in what we could do, and actually it was a liberation. We could achieve anything, and the explosions and pyrotechnics that we've achieved in the bombing run, I think have pushed us to a new level of believability. We've gone right into the ships, and we model, rather than modeling the outside first, we actually model from the inside out. So all as you destroy a ship, you're actually opening up holes and the viewer can see in, the audience can see in. It was really exciting to do, and I think it took the destruction to a new level. I think our contributions to films are getting more and more invisible in certain cases, but when they're not invisible because you know they can't be real, they're getting more believable. Globally, the visual effects techniques are so advanced now that it's now important to tell a good story. And it's now important that that story has good ideas and creative challenges that push us to create visuals that have never been seen before.